When bacterial growth is ceased by unfavorable environmental conditions, like lack of nutrients and high temperatures, it employs a survival strategy by producing structures within the cell called endospores. These endospores preserve the bacterial DNA and other essential cellular components during these tough conditions. Endospores are resistant to heat, chemicals, radiation, and desiccation. By entering this dormant state, bacteria can withstand the challenging environment. When conditions become more favorable for growth and reproduction, the endospore will transform into a vegetative cell. Gram-positive bacteria, like Bacillus, Clostridium, and a few other genera are known to produce endospores. These bacteria are found in various environments, including soil, water, and the gastrointestinal tracts of animals. Bacillus species, such as Bacillus anthracis, Bacillus cereus, and Bacillus subtilis are well known for their ability to form endospores. Similarly, Clostridium species, such as Clostridium tetani and Clostridium metulinum, also produce endospores. Endospores can survive for thousands of years under the right conditions. These are the most enduring forms of life on Earth. The survival ability of bacteria in harsh conditions has serious implications for public health, food safety, and environmental microbiology. Understanding these conditions is important to develop strategies to control microbial contamination and sterilization methods. There are two types of endospores, based on where they are positioned in the cell. Endospores located in the center of the cell are called central endospores, and the ones that are located at the end of the cell are called terminal endospores. Some spores are located between the center and end of the cell. These are called subterminal endospores. The structure of an endospore is highly specialized and consists of several distinct layers and components. Each layer serves a specific function in protecting the bacterial DNA and cellular components during the dormant state. This spore is externally surrounded by a thin layer called exosporium. It is composed of proteins and present only in some spore-forming bacteria. Beneath the exosporium, a spore coat is present. The spore coat is composed of several layers of proteins. It is a thick layer, and therefore helps prevent the entry of harmful chemicals into the endospore. Beneath the spore coat, cortex is present. It is made of peptidoglycan. However, it has fewer pentaglycine crosslinks compared to the cell wall peptidoglycan. The core wall lies beneath the cortex and surrounds the core. The core is the innermost part of the spore. It is also known as protoplast. The core is the central region of the endospore and contains the bacterial DNA, ribosomes, and essential enzymes. All these essential components are preserved in a condensed and dehydrated state. The DNA is protected from damage by the presence of small acid-soluble proteins, which bind to DNA molecules and stabilize them. The core also contains dipicolinic acid, about 15% of the dry weight of the spore. The actual function of dipicolinic acid is not completely known. However, it is believed that dipicolinic acid forms a complex with calcium ions and helps in removing the water molecules from the spore, causing dehydration of the spore. The process of formation of spores is called sporogenesis or sporulation. As we discussed earlier, the sporulation process is triggered when growth ceases due to lack of nutrients. In step one of this process, an axial filament of bacterial DNA is formed. In step two, the plasma membrane folds inwards and forms a septum to enclose the part of DNA. This developing structure is known as phospore. In step three, the plasma membrane of the mother cell continues to grow to engulf the phospore. In this stage, the phospore can be seen with two layers of plasma membranes. In step four, the cortex is formed, in the space between the two plasma membranes. In this stage, accumulation of calcium and dipicolinic acid is observed. In step 5, protein coats are formed around the cortex. In step 6, maturation of the spore occurs. A lot of dehydration takes place in this stage. Finally, in step 7, the spore gets released when the vegetative cell is degraded. The spores do not show any metabolic activities. They survive unfavorable conditions. As we discussed earlier, a spore can be transformed into a vegetative cell under favorable environmental conditions. The transformation of a spore to a vegetative cell happens in 3 stages: activation, germination, and outgrowth. This spore will not germinate on its own, even when it is put in a nutrient-rich medium. The activation process usually requires a heating treatment. The activation of the spore is followed by germination. In this stage, the spore loses its resistance to heat and other harmful factors. The calcium and dipicolinic acid will be released from the core. As a result, the core gets hydrated, and there will be an increased metabolic activity. After the germination, if nutrients continue to serve the spore, outgrowth will be initiated. In this stage, cell wall synthesis, protein synthesis, and enzyme activity can be seen. Finally, the spore develops into an active vegetative cell.